most, yes, thank you. Most of you, compared to average good people, I'm not even talking of an average worldly man, I'm talking of average good people, most of you are evolved. But somehow, many, I'm not talking about you people here, I'm talking the subject. Somehow, many people, even after coming here, listening, they somehow do not take the last step. They have their own notions. They feel, they will listen, they will meditate, something will happen. They do not realize there's nothing to happen in this. There's nothing to happen. You are already there. Only thing is you are confused. Clear the confusions through listening. And having known that, then simple, whatever is the ultimate subject that you are. Whatever is the ultimate subject that you are. What is the ultimate subject? I am seeing you. You are my objects. My eyes are seeing you. Eyes subject, you are object. Eyes, dead bodies, eyes cannot see. Mind sees through the eyes. Mind subject, eyes objects. Mind itself cannot see when there's no life. So mind is object, self-consciousness is the subject. That is the ultimate. There is, this self does not become an object to anything else. This self does not become an object to anything else. It is the subject. It is the subject. And always objects change. Subject never changes. So this consciousness that you are is not merely the subject in you, that is what you are. The same consciousness is existence, which is the very essence in all names and forms. There's nothing above it. In this, if you are attentive to me, you get the experience immediately. What is there to do sadhana? Sadhana are all for people who are totally attached to material world, completely attached to material world. They are not able to even listen to me properly and focus on what I say. Such people need to purify for them sadhana. People who have a reasonable, alert, pure mind, as I say, it should reveal to you. After that, yes, vasanas will be there. Doesn't matter. You know them to be vasanas. They go. You allow them to pass before you. You are a detached observer. There will be some vasanas even after this knowledge. But knowledge is immediate. Once you get this knowledge, you will never more be confused that you are the individual. And you are subject to all limitations and death. This knowledge instantly releases you in spite of all your problems and sorrows. They will be there, but you know them to belong to body, mind, or intellect. And you know them, you need them for purification. You know that they are being given by God. Therefore, total acceptance. This total acceptance is called surrender. These are the things that are said in the Isha first verse itself. Isha vasya medakam sarvam. tena tiktena, by renouncing all other identifications. Punjita, enjoy. So, even now, if some of you are not completely tuned and got this experience, take the help of some people who have known it. Why you want to waste your life? Having come to this stage, up to this stage, it's a rare blessing of the Lord. From stone to insects, from insects, probably animals, in between plants, from animal, you have come, taken the human form. What is the glory of this human form? In this human form, instantly you can know you are Brahman. Instantly, you can know you are Brahman. And after knowing that, you are totally independent of the external world. External world will be there. There will be challenges, problems. Even your body, mind, intellect will have problems. But that's also external world. Even body, mind, intellect are external world. You are an observer. That is the greatness of this human birth, where you have the guts to deny all gods. This glorious thing you have come, and what punya we have done, we do not know. We have not done, our ancestors have done their blessings. We come across a guru also. And what type of a guru? A guru not different from Brahman. A guru not different from Brahman. Having come to this much, can we afford to postpone this experience and living? Are we, should we not be ready when Lord Yama comes? Oh, I was waiting for you. Instead of he's asking you to come, you should be able to say, oh Lord, I was waiting for you. Let's go. You must be able to say that. Tapavan Maharaj did it. People were sympathetic. He said, I left this body long back. His body is hanging on in me. We should be able to say that when Lord Yama comes right now, when I'm speaking also. Oh, yeah, Yamaji, let us go. Or shall I finish the class for one half an hour and then we can go? Right? So, that is called freedom. Freedom from fear, freedom from death, freedom from sorrow. This is the ultimate. You somehow got a lot of garbage through your wrong living in number of lives. You were not able to understand this. Then Shastra doesn't leave anybody. Today you listen, Shastra won't leave anybody. It has got schemes to suit everybody. Like when you go to a mall, they say, we have got products to suit every pocket. Right? Here, Shastra has got schemes to suit everybody. So, if you're not ready for that, they say, live a honest, good family life. Knowing well this family life, fulfilling your desires, earning, must be according to dharma, artha, kama. Earning, desires must be according to dharma. When you do that, you get purified, then you will become fit for this knowledge. So, live a good, honest, religious life, dharmic life. That is called pravritti marga. first thing is called Nivritti Marga. They said there is no other way. There is no third way. And then the book gives us how to contemplate on that truth and feel that truth in you. Contemplate on the truth, then something will happen. No, contemplate and feel it in you. Contemplate and feel it in you. So, meditations have been given. Now I said, they don't leave anybody. Some people in the grihastha life, even living according to dharma, they have no idea of any other thing. They only know, and feed the family, and feed the family, build a good house, have a good car, enjoy life, malls, hotels, trips, parties. They cannot think something beyond this. They think that's the end of it. And as long as a person thinks that's the end of it, don't disturb him. Don't tell him this is not the right way to live. Because he has to grow out of it. He has to see its end. He has to fully go through that life and realize this is not enough for me. This is not enough for me. And when that man starts further searching, he will be told, you can go to Swarga, enjoy better. I was told many of these violent people, ill people who kill others in the name of religion and all that. I was told this is the incentive that you fight for religion, you go to heaven, you will get best of liquor, best of women and all that. So these people have that aspiration. So they do certain rituals and meditations to go to Swarga, etc. Some people even lesser than that. I want to control everybody's mind. Vashikarana. For that, they do upasana. For wealth, they do upasana. Vashikaranam, they do upasana. Right? I must have siddhis. They do upasana. So different people seek differently. I read to you last time from Bhagavatam how people want each thing, they invoke a different god. I read all that last time. If you have missed it, Bhagavatam, second skanda, third chapter. It says, what god if you worship, what you will get. Right? To include, they say, if you are Stri Kama, you want a woman, Urvashi you invoke. Like that, they give various things. They do upasana for that. They do upasana. And then they get it. How? Array, you are God, sir. Whatever you think, you get it. Whatever you think continuously, consistently, you will get it. Because it's all in your mind. It's all in your mind. You want to be Indra, you will be Indra. You want to be Kubera, you will be Kubera. Think continuously about that. Our problem is we do not think about one thing. Second thing, even many things when you think, you don't think continuously. You are not single-pointed. And you are not consistent. Therefore, you don't succeed. Otherwise, because all these Kubera, Indra are all mind. Whatever you think, the mind will make you that. The mind will make you that. So that is how, if you do Upasana, you will become that God. If you do karmas, rituals, you will get results. All those results are only catering to physical needs, including you get through your effort or through rituals, only physical needs. When you get things, physical needs, what happens is you maintain the families, continuity is maintained. The ancestry is maintained. The traditions are maintained. Therefore, that is called Pitru Loka. Pitru means ancestors, father. Pitru Loka. When you do rituals and all that, you get things to survive and carry on. That's called Pitru Loka. That's all you will get. These lokas are mostly because they are fields of experiences. We also use, you know, world of doctors, lokas of doctors, lokas of advocates, lokas of business people. You understand? World of doctors, world of advocates, world of business people. World and loka is the same. So they are fields of experiences. They are there in this world. If you leave the body, they are there in the astral plane also. They are coordinated by God here. They are coordinated by God in the astral plane also. So the lokas, yes, in a way real, because we experience them in the mind. And according to the mind, your outside world also caters to you. You are a drunkard, where will you go? You will go to temple, you will go to the bar. So that's your loka. The world also is your loka. Right? You are a lover of God, where will you go? To the bar. You won't go. You will go to the temple. So each one goes to his loka. First he experiences that loka in his mind. Then he goes to the external loka. So it is there in this world itself. If you die, because all our minds are there in the astral plane, everything is there in the minds, everything is there in the astral plane. There also you have lokas. Here also managed by God. They are also managed by God. But to me, I cannot categorically say, because it is not right for me to unsettle the minds of people who believe in this. Because Shastras say there are 26, 27 Narakas itself. Bhagavatam gives clearly and says, I am giving description, you can book wherever you want. Whichever naraka you want, you book. And they also say 7 lokas up, 7 lokas down. So Shastra says, people don't disturb them. They say, yes, they are there. But to me, common sense, there cannot be geographical areas. Then you need again there Hindu world, Christian world, Muslim world in the astral plane. So to me, they are there in the astral plane, true. They are there in the astral plane, but not geographical areas. Geographical, physical areas. That is my opinion. You go by your this thing, because there are three norms to decide the meaning. One, time-tested statement, Shruti. Two, it should be logical, Yukti. Three, it should be commensurate with your experience, Anubhava. Shruti, Yukti, Anubhava, that is how you decide the Tatparya, Tatparya Nirnaya. Right? To me, Yukti, common sense, doesn't appeal to me that there are geographical areas. But I don't deny that these lokas are there. These lokas are here or in the astral plane also. Whatever you choose, you think about that, you will get that. Whatever God you continuously think, that you become. This is upasana. This is upasana. What is upasana? Upa, near. Asana, sitting. Upa, near, asana, sitting. So, you keep something there, an ideal, in the form of an idol, and try to reach there through your mind, close to that ideal. Mentally, you try to reach that ideal closely, you become closer to that. So you are sitting very close to that ideal. This is called upasana. Please listen, I am going very slow because this class is most important. All of you, if this one class you can understand without doubt, you can understand any Upanishad, any Shastra, anywhere spoken. If you miss this particular class, you will always have doubts, because I will be touching on, without doubt, lokas, gods, upasanas, krama mukti, videha mukti, jivan mukti, all these points I will be touching. But when I do, how I do not know, because you cannot speak with a book on hand, seeing and talking from your heart. This has to be spoken from your heart. You lift your mind to God, and God, Guru, speaks through you. So I do not know the order, but he does it. I may miss, but I will say again, this is also there. Somehow you will get all the information, but in order or it's not in order, that I don't know. So I told you what is a loka, what is upasana. Upasana is sitting close to an ideal, because you can't concentrate on an abstract ideal, you make it into an idol. That is upasana. And now, this upasana, you make the idea. You take clay. Make Krishna in that. You know, Navaratri, same clay, same material they use, same colors they use, but forms are different. Same clay, same colors, same baking. They make Krishna out of that. They make Rama out of that. They make Ganesha out of that. Navaratri is coming. They make Ravana out of that. They make Rama out of that. From the same clay. The same way. Now, you buy that for Ganesh Chauti, that Ganesha from the market. For Janmashtami, you buy Krishna. For Sri Rama Navami, you buy Rama. And you do puja, do you do thinking that this is my duty, or you think that there is God in that? Will you carelessly treat that idol? Will you do something undignified before that idol. You treat that idol as God. It's clay. But the moment you have invoked that there, you treat it as God. And it is God, because God is everywhere. Wherever you invoke, in whatever form, he responds to you. God is there everywhere. Wherever you invoke him, however you invoke him, he responds to you. So Ganesha idol is Ganesha, not idol. Rama idol is Rama. Krishna idol is Krishna. They are all real gods. But who gave them the power as gods? How did clay become Ganesha? How did clay become Krishna? How did clay become Rama? Oh, that potter did it. Okay, potter did it. You bought it, you pray it as Ganesha, Krishna, Rama. What about an atheist takes it? A man who doesn't believe in every religion takes it. Will he get that blessing? Will he see Krishna, Rama, Ganesha in that? Clay, that idol is not an idol, it's a murti. It's a personification of what you invoke. It is Ganesha, Ganesha, Krishna, Krishna, Rama, Rama. No doubt in that. But it's not for all. For you, who made that idol the Lord, who is present there, it's you. You invoked it. That's called invocation. All the prayers are invoking the God in you. The God is there in you. You invoke him. But there is a slight difference between prayer and invoking. In invocation, you try to invoke that power, that God in you, visualizing. In prayer, you give a list to him. I want this. I want that. I don't know. I given a list long back. Still, he kept me bachelor. 82 years. So you give a list to him. That is prayer. Invocation is, you invoke him in you. Badram karnebi pashyamaha hari. I'm quoting wrong. Badram pashyema chavihi. Some of my mind is in a different wavelength, so I'm not getting the right words. Let's forget. Badram karnebi srunayama devaha. Badram pashyema chavihi yajatraha. So, through the eyes, let us see auspiciousness. Through the ears, let us hear auspicious things. You invoke that power in you. You decide to see auspicious things, you will see everything as auspicious. You listen to auspicious things, you want to listen, you will listen everything auspicious. Because you have decided. That's called invocation. That's called invocation. So, this is upasana. You can invoke Puttichatan in that. You can invoke Indra in that. You can invoke Rambha Urvasi in that. You can invoke Ganesha, Krishna, Rama in that. It's up to you. Each one invokes what he wants from that. That is called upasana. That is called upasana. And whatever you invoke, you take that form. You go to that loka, you enjoy that loka. In karma, you get the results of your actions and you enjoy materially, physically. Now, you please see, whatever you enjoy in this world, it's still finite. And whatever you enjoy through your prayers and religion rituals cannot give you everything that you love to have in life. They will give you only what you have invoked. You cannot be invoking everything. Your one life is not enough. That's why you go on coming again and again into this world. Because you have got a big list. You've got a big list. So they are finite. And whatever you want, God will give you. But what about your health to enjoy that? Age to enjoy that? You didn't ask for that, God won't give you. Miserable life. Slavish life. And for that, what you can achieve in this world through your efforts, again, why do you want to pray to God for this miserable life? You pray, spend money, and get a miserable life. So some people want subtle enjoyments like swarga and all that. They do upasana. That's again finite. Bhagavatam beautifully explains in the 10th chapter of the 11th skanda how, due to your punya karma, you were sent a plane. Exact words, I'm not exaggerating. A plane with music. Even to take you, there are music, there are dancers from here to go to swarga in that plane. And when you go there, red carpet. And shelf is full of all brands of liquor. Made in India and made in heaven. Made in India, made in heaven. All sorts of liquor. Dancing girls, Rambha, Urvasi, Manaka, and all that. And sightseeing. You go one round, take two rounds of liquor, see two dancers. They say your time is out because what is 100 years there is only 10 minutes there. 100 years there, that's all the punya you earn. So 10 minutes you did it, your punya is over. What they do? Bhagavata says this. They throw you down unceremoniously. They throw you down unceremoniously. For this you are doing upasana. For this you are doing upasana. Not merely that. You are doing upasana to enjoy swarga. Who enjoys the highest in swarga? Indra. What is his state? The fellow cannot sleep. Because if anybody does 100 Ashwamedha Yagas, he becomes Indra. And there are a lot of people, because Ashwamedha Yagas in the olden days had a different meaning. Today it may have a different meaning. Somebody asked Mahapariyava. Today we have no Ashwamedha Yagas. What do we do? Mahapariyava said, cremate an unclaimed dead body, it's equivalent to an Ashwamedha Yaga. Cremate an unclaimed dead body, it's equivalent to an Ashwamedha Yaga. So who knows all these shastras? There may be several things. So when you do that, you become Indra. So that Indra is restless. Ashwamedha Yaga, that horse is important. So when you do 99, when you are doing the 100, he will always come and steal the horse. He did that to Didipa. He asked, where is my horse? Stolen by Indra. Didipa said, to go to swarga, I am doing this 100th time to become Indra. I become Indra for what? Stealing. I don't want to be Indra. I better live as a Ikshvaku, respectable king. He didn't do the 100th yaga. I don't want to become a thief. Doing 100 Ashwamedha Yagas, become Indra. This is the highest you can get either through karma or upasanas. karma, material things, upasanas, swarga loka, etc. All other lokas are less than that. Agni loka, vayu loka, varana loka, less than that. Do you want to go there? Hare, you are Brahman. All worlds are in you. In your own house, you made all the servants, masters, and you become a beggar with them in your own house. What a shame. Shastra cries. Shastra cries. They explain to you step by step. This is what you will get out of karma. This is what you will get out of upasana. They explain to you. You think they are encouraging. They say, stupid fellow, do you need this? Why can't you directly choose God? Why can't you directly choose God? Right? So the karmas are called avidya. Avidya, ignorance is one meaning. Another meaning is that which is not vidya. Vidya is upasana or knowledge. Vidya is upasana or knowledge. So avidya is that which is not upasana or knowledge or ignorance. Karma is called avidya because why karma? You need something. Why do you need something? You don't have it. Why you don't have it? Because you consider yourself to the body, mind, intellect. There are several things you think you want and you don't have it. Therefore, karma. In between not having and karma is the desire. Not having, because you think you are the body, that is ignorance. Ignorance of the spiritual dimension of yours. Ignorance at spiritual level becomes desire at the mind-intellect level, becomes action at the physical level. So action is nothing but one phase of ignorance. Ignorance of the spiritual dimension makes you desire and therefore gives you, makes you do the karma. So karma is only a form, a phase of avidya. Therefore, it's called avidya. Right? And the other is called upasana. So now, the Shastra says what you will get if you do karmas, what you will get if you do upasana, and what are the limitations? Do you need it? Should you go after them? All these Shastra, our Upanishad discusses. Now, I told you karma, upasana, jnana. And this is same thing as the four purusharthas, the four pursuits of human beings, dharma, artha, kama, moksha. These are the same four things also, deciding the different worlds, and caste. Gita said this, Bhagavad Gita said this. Chaturvidha bhajante maam janaha. Four types of devotees worship me. Who? Artharthi, those who don't have money, wealth, they pray to me. Jignasu, Arthaha, one who is in distress, Gajendra, Draupadi, one who is in distress prays to me. artha. Jignasu, most of us, curious to know, that's all. What does Gita say? What does Upanishad say? Curious, most of us. First is artha, physical level. Artha, emotional level. Jignasu, intellectual level. Right? Intellectual level. In this, artha is better than artharthi, and jignasu is better than the two. Mind is better than the body. Intellect is better than the body and mind. But all are finite. You learn so many Upanishads. Brahma Sutra. Brahma Sutra has 6-7 bhashyas. All that you have learned. What will you get? Headache. You will get nothing but headache. Ego. I learned this. You suffer more than the ordinary man. He doesn't have this ego. What do you get? All finite. All finite. What will release you from this finite bondage and make you God? Instant realization. I am not the body, I am not the mind, I am not the intellect. I am the owner of the body, I am the owner of the mind, I am the owner of the intellect. He who sees the body, mind, intellect is the seer. That is me, the subject. This is instant. You are released forever. After that, you may have body problem, but you will say, that's my body. After that, you may get angry. You will say, that's my mind. You are not getting associated with that. And in that experience, our Paramaguru says, it's like taking bath on a sunny day in Ganges. Half of your body is in waters, enjoying the coolness. Half is exposed to sun. You will have both. Because you are in the Vyavahara world, the heat of the Vyavahara world, and the composure, happiness, bliss of the inner world, you have both. But for a man who is there inside the inside experience of Atman, the Vyavahara world is insignificant. And when the man who is taking bath in Ganges is exposed to the sun, what does he do when the heat is too much? Take a dip into Ganges. When the world is too much, what do? Take a dip into the consciousness. How? Feel the consciousness. Difficult. Say, Krishna, Rama, finished. Matter over. How Krishna, Rama say matter over? You have shifted the mind from the problem to Krishna and Rama. When the mind shifts, you are released from the problem. When you cry, Krishna, Rama, you have shifted the mind. All workable, practical, sir. You don't have the faith, therefore you don't get it. Simple, immediate, workable, practical. So four types of devotees. Artha. Artha. Gita chapter 7. Kama, moksha. Now if the man is not ready for moksha, artha and kama do according to dharma. Artha and kama earn and satisfy your desires according to dharma. Dharma aviruddho bhuteshu, Gita says. That kama aviruddho, the dharma aviruddho kamaha, the desire that is not against dharma, you can go through before you go to Jnana Marga. Before you go to Jnana Marga. It's permitted. So these are the four types. So now first Jnani is the highest, one who knows God. Bhagavan says, Krishna in the 7th chapter, there is no difference between him and me. That is the highest. Bahunam janmanam ante jnanavan ma prapadyate vasudevaha sarvamiti. He says everything is Vasudeva. And between him and me, there is no difference. This is the highest. Next, people like us listening. Inquisitive people. Then next, artha, distress. Last, artha. So first shloka is jnana. Second shloka is artha kama according to dharma. Artha kama according to dharma. Now these upasanas and all that for gaining subtle joys. You are not happy with grosser joys. Right? For the same artha rituals. For the same kama upasana. Right? Now, artha also finite. Upasana also finite. And you are not fit for jnana. What do? Same rituals dedicated to God. Ishvara Prityartham. For the sake of God, to make him happy. Ishvara Arpitam Nechaya Kritam. Offer to God without selfish desire. Do the same karma. Do the same karma. And upasana, you meditate on the higher manifest God, Devata. So upasana you have to do because you cannot think of abstract things. Choose a God. Karmas you have to do. Do selflessly. When you do this, your mind gets purified, gets power to integrate the mind intellect, that becomes fit for meditation. What happens in this process? That is, you have done karma and then upasana. What happens? You are gradually growing in spiritual standards. You're not got moksha like the first shloka man instantly. Nor are you stuck with the people who are doing rituals and upasanas. You are gradually growing yourself because you have tuned your mind to God, having purified it to avidya, invoking him, there is a gradual elevation and evolution. This is called gradual liberation. Gradual liberation. First thing is jivan mukti, sadhyo mukti, immediate. And the other two, swarga and karma, go and come back, go and come back, go and come back. Every day, holiday, and come back and suffer. Holiday, come back and suffer. That is the two other paths. But this is krama mukti. You invoke that God slowly with having done the karmas, you go to that God, then you will go to the next God, then you will go to the next God, then you go to swarga, then because you are continuously meditating also. Meditating, doing karmas, you become fit. Then at the level of swargaloka, Brahmaji comes and takes you to his loka. There, till his time, Brahmaji's time, millions of years, you go on listening to classes like this. And when Brahmaji's time ends, you get moksha. That is called krama mukti, gradual liberation. Gradual liberation. First is immediate liberation. Next is go for artha, kama. Then subtle kamas. Then gradual liberation. That is, if you are not fit for the first, choose this. That is, do karmas to purify and do higher devata upasana so that you can integrate the mind intellect, get at least gradual liberation, kramamu. These two are accepted norms. It's not that you should do only for desires rituals or upasana for gaining those gods. They're all finite. either you gain immediate knowledge or purify the mind through karma, then do upasana meditation, higher meditation, and then get gradual liberation. This is acceptable. And then here, upasana is defined as nikrushta vastuni utkrushta darshanam. In an inferior object, you impose a higher ideal. In clay, you impose Krishna, Rama, and all that. That's called upasana. Nikrushta darshanam. Nikrushta vastuni utkrushta darshanam. Nikrushta, in an insignificant object, you invoke the higher ideal. Right? So now, through avidya, you purify. Through upasana, you try to elevate yourself. These two to be done, not together, to be done, but not together. Because without purification of the mind, you do upasana, you will suffer because you don't, your mind is not ready to take that experience. Everything is dark to you without purifying the mind. Purify the mind through karma and then do upasana. Both must be done, but not simultaneously, serially. They are called anga angi. Serially purify the mind through karma and then upasana. And then upasana, anga angi, higher contemplation, right? This leads to kramamukti. This will lead you to kramamukti. That is appreciated. If you cannot get jivan mukti, at least purify the mind through karma and elevate yourself through upasana, right? Kramamukti. That is the subject matter of the next six verses. Next six verses. I'll just read the three verses and leave there. I request all of you to read the book and you will find enough confusions, because the subject matter is that. It's not the book confuses. The subject matter without a guidance leads to several doubts and confusions. The subject matter is that. Gurudev has taken all those people's opinions and gives his own opinion. Because I said in the very first class, whatever anybody says is right, because truth is infinite, it can be seen differently, and all of them are right. Nobody is wrong. So also, this avidya, this upasana, how it works, can also have different opinions. All of them are right. So whoever says anything is right. So Gurudev explains different opinions and gives his own opinion. And because everybody is right, you choose what you want. Since everybody is right, you choose what you want. So I will do the verses. Read at home. See the contradictions. See where you have problems to understand. Before the next class, you start corresponding to me in WhatsApp or talk to me on telephone. Clear those doubts. And next class, we'll definitely conclude Isavasya. Next class definitely will conclude Isavasya. Right now, I do the first three verses of the six verses. Andham, ninth verse. Andham tamaha pravishanti yo avidyam upasate ततो भूय यमते तमो य उ विद्यायाम रताः. The one who does rituals, invokes karma, goes to dark worlds. because he doesn't know what to gain, what to get. He's blindly doing certain things because somebody said, do it. This will give you this, this will give you that. Right? Some people do it for money, and that money alone gives problems. Some people do it for wife, and he has invoked maximum problem. Right? And some people invoke it for children. We were told that your enemies in the past life become your children in this life. Okay. So therefore, it's all dark. You have no clear idea. But what happens to people who do upasana? They go even to darker regions because at least this will purify. There, you become a greater slave, wanting subtler joys. So it is even darker than this. Avidya, at least gradually you get purified. It's concrete. There it is not even concrete. You cannot physically verify it. And it will make you more dependent. And therefore even darker. That's what it says. Andam tamaha. Great darkness they go. Pravishanti. Yo avidyam upasate. Right? Those who worship avidya go to blinding darkness. Those who worship the devatas, vidya, they fall even through greater darkness. So what to do? He says, I will give the answer in the next. In between, I'll have to give you some information. The author says, Anya deva ahuhu vidyaya, Anya ahuhu avidyaya, iti sushruma dhirana, ye naha tad vichakshire. Tad vichakshire. Those who explain Shastras to us, tat, that rule, vichakshire explained, anyat, different, eva, definitely, ahuhu, vidyaya, there is a different experience and world through upasana. Vidya means upasana. Here, vidya is knowledge that's different. In the context where we are doing, vidya is upasana, avidya is karma. So, vidya, you have got a different world and experience. Avidyaya, through avidya, you have another experience. Avidya, I have explained to you, you get traditional Pitruloka, through vidya, Devaloka. Deva means senses. So, the world of senses and subtle joys, that is Devaloka, vidya. Avidya, Pitruloka, Artha Kamastu, Pitruloka. Avidya, Pitruloka. Vidya, Devaloka. Both are different. And if you do avidya, you go to blinded in darkness. If you do vidya, even greater darkness. So what you should do? Vidya cha avidyam cha yastad vedo bhayam saha avidya mrutyum tirtva vidya amrutam asnute. You practice both, but serially. Do both serially. Purify through karma. Through upasana, you elevate. The mind intellect get integrated, it can focus to knowledge, you gradually liberate. This gradual liberation does not mean only after death you go to various lokas and gradually. Even here, so many people, when I talked on the first class, they would have gone. Others are gradually getting released according to their purification through their day-to-day living karma. According to their tapas prayers, Gurudev and God and all that. So gradually they are liberated. So gradual liberation, not merely in the astral plane, it can happen here also. 99% are gradually. We don't get it on the first day. Right? Slowly we are purifying ourselves in our life through changing our way of living. Gradually we are meditating and praying, gradually getting liberated. This is called Krama Mukti. So don't have mystic views. These are all practical. It happens here, it will happen in the astral plane. So avidya and vidya should be practiced. Serially, avidya, purify, vidya, meditate. Then what happens? You will get gradual liberation. Right? So we'll see more of it next class. Next class, I will somehow conclude this Ishavasya next class. Meanwhile, because this one book you understand, you will understand any book anywhere. If this one book is not clear to you, everywhere you seem to understand, but your doubts will be there. And this is simplest 18 verses. And in that, 6 verses are talking the same thing. So, study, listen to my tape. Today, you listen that Zenith also. You don't have to listen from the beginning. Today, you listen 2-3 times. Study, mark your doubts. Contemplate whether you can clear your doubts by yourself. Otherwise, message me. Otherwise, talk to me. By next class, if you are clear, you are blessed. And what? I am blessed. Right? So, Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamadachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Harihi Om Sri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om. Please give me your feedback.